Last class we had left in this slide, I think. So we'll start from here today. So ethics and the internet. When you are using the internet, what are the ethical things we need to keep in our mind? First thing is acceptance. That means whatever activity somebody is doing on the internet, you know, at the time of doing it, people should remember or consider acceptance of the activity towards the other people who are on the internet or who are going to be affected by the activity. Like it can be a simple one, like you are posting something on the social media. So before posting it, you or anybody, whoever is posting, must be concerned about the acceptance of the post to the audience. Audience means, you know, whoever is in the friend list and whoever else can see your post. The person must consider all of them, because some post can be, you know, harm somebody's sentiment, it can harm somebody's belief, or even it can provoke somebody to do something illegal and unexpected, right? So this is the first consideration ethically people should consider when they are doing something on the internet. Even it can be at the time of posting some video or some any other document or anything. Then sensitivity to national and local cultures. This is another important thing. When we are posting something, or somebody is posting something or doing something, or any activity, so people should have some ethical value to respect the national and local cultures. Okay, it should not hurt local or national beliefs and sentiments. Okay, while using email and chatting, that time also all these ethical things should be considered. Then pretending someone else, this is totally unethical thing and avoidable, and by law it is a crime. Okay. Then avoid bad language on the internet, hide personal information. Then downloading, whenever people are downloading something, they must be careful about Creative Commons guidelines. Basically, Creative Commons gives license for different document on the internet. Okay, so I'll show you that how it works. Okay, then supervision. That means people should be vigilant when they are using internet. Then encourage children to use internet, access to the internet. Okay, so professional code of ethics, if you see, a professional code of ethics states the principle and core values that are essential to the work of a particular occupational group. Okay, so you can understand it. The professional code of ethics is a bit different from the ethical values we speak about in large, when you say ethical value when you are using internet, ethical values when you are using a computer system. It is a bit different. Definitely, it stands on those ethics only. Like, for example, you can see the Association of Computer Machinery, ACM, quite popular name among the engineers, has code of ethics and professional conduct. People can check it out from this URL. Then Association of Information Technology Professional, AITP, provides quality IT-related education, information on relevant IT issues, and forums for networking with experienced peers and other IT professionals. So the AITP also has code of ethics. Okay. Then other examples are like IEEE is another quite popular name among us in engineering people. So Computer Society of IEEE is also having their code of conduct or ethical codes. So the software engineering code of ethics and professional practices, they also have documented. Okay, then Project Management Institute is another one. This institute is also established the PMI member code of ethics. So most of the time, whenever you will join some company or organization, on the very first day you will get some booklet describing all the ethical values they have, what they think is correct, for what they stand for what they against. Okay, you will find many things it will be written there that we are against racial activity or any sexist activity, all these things that they will note it down there. Even what you can do on the internet using the on the internet, and then what you can do using the organizations or companies resources. Can you take a printout for your kids or some of your personal letter from the company printer? That is also need to be. Usually, it is also going to be written on the code of conduct document. So Association of Computing Machinery Code Ethics, some highlights are here. 24 imperatives of personal responsibility contains issues that professionals will have to deal with. Section 1, general moral imperatives. Section 2, professional conduct. Section 3, individual with leadership, roles like create opportunities for people. The first one, if you see, is general moral imperatives like avoid harm to other. That means when you are in an organization, you will find that there will be many employees. They intentionally, knowingly does things and which can harm other. Say making some comment or disclosing some information, and they know that if I disclose the information, I am not going to be affected, but such particular other person is going to be affected. So all these things are general moral imperative. Next is section 2, if you see, it speaks about professional conduct, like maintain professional competence. What is this? We will see that many times it happens that in a group, people are working, and suddenly you will find that one of the member of the group taken all the taken all the credit of the work. Okay, so these are the things what decrease the professional competence in the organization. So that is what avoidable, that should be maintained properly. Then individual with leadership, what the leader should do, that they like create opportunities for people. So here, leader should be such a act in such way that he is giving equal opportunity for everyone, right? So all these things, section 3 speaks about. Then section 4, compliance with the ethical code, like it promote the general ethics. Okay. Then acceptable use policies is AUP. Okay, so this is something given by AUP, by Virginia Tech. So Virginia Tech is a university, I think many of you know. Okay, so if you see here, individual may, you can see here, individual may not access, copy, add, alter, damage, delete, or destroy any data or computer software on any other computer unless specifically authorized. So what it is stating that somebody can't himself can access any computer, copy data from any computer, add or alter data, damage anything including data, okay, and delete or destroy any data or computer software. Like somebody got a computer, which is not locked, and suddenly he felt, let's uninstall few of the software from it. So that is also unethical. Or any other computer unless specifically authorized. That means specifically authorized means if somebody with some authority specifically give authorize that person that you go and delete this software, go and copy this data, then only it can be done. Otherwise people should not be should not do this. Okay, then students shall be held accountable for his or her own behavior and for the appropriate activity originating from his or her unit of computer. So understand, so the students are, as this is the university's code of conduct, the students are themselves responsible for whatever behavior or activity are going to be happened or originating from their unit of computer. All passwords should be secure by the students only. Okay. Then common ethical issues in IT users. First one comes with the very common software privacy. Most of the people you will find don't care about the software privacy. A common violation occurs when the employee copy software from their work computer for use at home. So many people does it. It is very common. No? And certainly they got say Microsoft 360 or some Microsoft Office passcode of the organization. They take it home for their home computers as well. Okay. Then inappropriate use of computing resources. Like some employees use their work computers to surf popular websites that have nothing to do with their jobs. So this is an old survey. You can see here, half of the Fortune 500 companies have dealt with at least one incident related to computer porn in the workplace over the last 12 months, according to a survey released. Even that survey is in released in 2005. Now, corporations are taking the problem seriously and fire the offenders in 44% of the cases and disciplined those responsible in 41% of the instances. Okay, so you can understand how important it is to maintain the code of ethics when people are in the workplace and using the organization's computer and resources. So this was the survey by China Martins. Computer porn remains issue at US companies. Computer World, June 21st, 2005. Then common ethical issues in IT user. Next is inappropriate sharing of information. This is very important and very, you can say very big problem for the organization. The organization store vast amount of information that can be classified as private and or confidential. You can understand, right? Most of the organizations nowadays, they store all the employees data. Employees data means all personal data of employees are there with them. Then customers data and everything, right? So they should not be leaked easily. But what happens, private data describe individual employees, for example, salary, attendance, performance rating, health record, all these things. Okay. Now, confidential information describes the company and its operation, operations like sales, promotion, plan, then research and development outputs, all these things. Right. They are very confidential for a company. Now, sharing this information with unauthorized party, even inadvertently, has violated someone's privacy or created potential that the company information could fall into hand of the competitors. What will happen if the competitor company gets some company's promotion plan or what research they are doing, what output of the research is coming out, what is their sales data, all these things, if goes to the opponent company or competitor company's hand, then it may become a face loss for the company as well as monetary loss for the company. Okay. Next is defining and limiting the appropriate use of IT resources. Like companies must develop, communicate, and enforce written guidelines that encourage employees to respect corporate IT resources and the use of them to enhance their job performance. Effective guidelines allow some level of professional use while prohibiting employees from visiting objectionable websites or using company's email to send offensive or harassment messages. Right? So people must understand that the internet provided by the organization is not for accessing the objectionable websites, even the social media, or for anything, for personal use. The company is paying for the internet only for their growth. So employees should respect that. At the same time, the company email, email ID provided by the company to the employees, it should not be used for any of the personal communication, as well as very important is this email ID should not be used for sending any offensive or harassing messages to others. Okay. Establishing guidelines for use of company software. Like company IT managers must provide clear rules that govern the use of home computers and associated software. That means whether the employees can take a copy of the software for their home use or not, that instruction must be given very clearly to the employees. The goal should be to ensure employees have legal copies of all software. Right? Then, structuring information system to protect data and information. So, implement system and procedure that limit data access to employees who need it. Employees should be prohibited from accessing the data about research and development results, product formulate, and staffing projections if they don't need it to do their job. Then, installing and maintaining corporate firewall. This is another important thing. Firewall is a software or hardware device that serves as barrier between a company and the outside world. That means, say, this is some company, say, LJDI. Okay. And this is the internet. Now, if it have a seamless connection between the internet and the company, what will happen? These employees there in the company, they will able to access anything from the internet, right? So how to stop it? Or even this company is having database servers. Okay, so all the you can say classified data or confidential data are there. So what can happen that from somebody, some attacker from the internet can access this confidential data, right? So how to stop it? So one way of doing it is putting a firewall here, okay? So the connection is going to be passed through this firewall, okay? And this is going to act as a filter, you can say it is something like a filter. Okay, so what happens, it becomes the barrier between the company's network and the internet or the world, okay, and limit access to the company's network based on the internet users policy. Now the firewall, and on the firewall many rules can be implemented, that what site can be visited from the company, what URL should be blocked. And from outside the from the internet, who can access the company's network or log into the company's network? Or nobody can, if you don't need, you should block everything, every incoming request for logging into the network. Okay, so that it can be secure. Okay, then firewall can be configured to serve as an effective detergent. Unauthorized web surfing by blocking access to specific objectionable websites. So this is what I already told you. Then Firewall can serve as effective barrier to incoming emails from certain websites, companies, or users. So this firewall can block some emails also, like, you know, some email is coming from some suspected domain, it can be blocked. Okay, even there is some suspected attachment, that can be also checked by the firewall and it can be blocked. Okay, now can be programmed to block email with certain kind of attachment, because, you know, most of the time it happens that with the email attachment, some virus can enter to the company's network. Okay, then which reduces the risk of harmful computer viruses. Then the security of IT used in business is very important, although the necessary security is obvious. It often must be balanced against other business needs and issues. IT professionals and IT users all face a number of ethical decisions regarding IT security. Okay. Now, ethical decision regarding IT security, business managers, IT professionals, and then IT users all face a number of ethical decisions regarding IT security. Right. And then if their firm is a victim of computer crime, should they pursue persecution of the criminal at all the cost, or should they maintain a low profile to avoid the negative publicity, or must they inform their attached customers, or should they take some other action? So here it is very important and critical situation happens with a company. Now, if you look at our recent events in last year, IRCTC, Big Basket, were the few companies who had data losses from their servers, right? Huge amount of data loss was there, and all the data was mostly customers' data, right? We all use IRCTC for train ticket booking and Big Basket for local shopping, right? Now, question comes here. When this threat happened, does immediately these companies logged some case against the offenders? First thing. Now, why this question is coming? The reason is that these companies are very professional, right? So their data is already lost. It is sold in the dark web. They already detected it. Now, question is that if this company is going to, you know, file a case and, you know, follow it up, then this company need to recruit again some legal people. That will cost for this company. Why does this company, you know, file a case and run this, you know, follow this up? Better for, they can forgive it, right? So, so that this company will save some of their money. Okay. So if they accept this, okay, happened. So what can we do? Better save some money. Okay, so that is what, you know, maintaining the low profile. Okay. At the same time, some ethical things are there, right? Then, before this, if, you know, as soon as this data, this news going to get public, you know, this company are going to lose customers, because this customer will no longer believe them, okay, at least for next few years. In India, things are different. I have seen that starting from the very, you know, poor people to, you know, at the highest status and holder people in the society, nobody care about their personal data confidentiality. Okay. In India, the people think that our data, personal data, it is of zero value. Okay, and that is the reason that in India, you know, cyber crimes are happens very frequently, because most of the people's personal data are available. Okay, so but in other country, if it is in USA or some other country, this company will get, you know, a huge amount of, you know, customer loss immediately. Okay, And government will also take a big action against this company. But in India, you know what happened to this company. There, I don't. I have no news that anything happened or any penalty was imposed on this company. That how careless you were. You are handling, you are storing the user's data, your customer's data. How can it be leaked? You will see that you know the political people will fight for the data collection of. Aadhaar, right? So before few years, it was a big debate, right? Why government is collecting people's data? It can be leaked, and people will lose everything. But where are those people when these companies are losing data? Where are those people? They are not taking anything, right? So in India, the situation, at least I feel, that is different. Okay. Then must inform the affected customer. Now question is that. Okay, you lose the data. Now, does these companies inform the customers whose data was leaked? Your data is being stolen from our server, so you change your credential, you can change your username, password, if you are using the same password in other website, right? So many, you can change your credit card PIN, credit card number even. Right, so all these things need to be done for the customer also. But does this company inform these customers that your data was stolen from our server? So this is big ethical issue, but most of the cases, I don't think these companies inform the customers. Okay, now, how much effort effort and money should be spent to safeguard against computer crime? Now, how safe is safe enough? Now, again, this is another point that how much investment the companies will do to safe, to make their data safe, because for behind the security, they there is no limit of investment. How much investment they can do, but from the ethical point of view, if you are collecting the customer's data, then they must invest into it. Right. Otherwise, don't store the customer data. You sell something and immediately you flush the data. Right. Now, if their firm produces software with defects that allow hackers to attack the customer data and computers, what actions should they take? Do you understand? So, Microsoft came up with the new software. Many times it happened in the past that immediately new operating system launched, within few days there is a zero day attack. Attacker found some loophole in the design of the software, and they was able to attack numerous number of computer over the world. Now question is that who is the developer of the software, who is the seller of the software? Does they compensate this their customer? It never happens that the software company is compensating the customer. Say I have purchased antivirus, okay, and I have updated it up to date. Now, even after that, if my computer is going to be infected by virus which was which is an old one, this virus is not a new one. So say in that case, this computer virus company can't claim that it is a new virus, so we was not able to protect your data. So it is an old virus. It happens. If an old virus, and say it is a few month old virus, affects my computer, will the antivirus company compensate me? So it never happens. These are what ethical things between the software developers, developing companies, and the customers. What tactics should management ask employees to use to gather competitive intelligence without doing anything illegal? Because it happens that many times, the companies collects your data without your permission or without letting you know. Like you will find many times it happens that you visit some website of for some product, you find that after some time they are able to track you, who you are, and they are started, you know, sending messages or phone calls that if you are still interested for this product, or, you know, you can take it and all. Okay, so these are basically unethical things, and it happens, you know, in the software companies, the developers, software developers can do it very easily using the cookies. Okay, immediately you are going to, you know, you are going to visit a website. The website will put a cookie on your browser, and that cookie will just track your location, your other credentials saved in the browser, right? And if possible, your phone number and even your email ID, then it will send back to the company server. So cookies communicates back to the server without our permission. Okay, it happens all the time. And many websites will find that they will, you know, as soon as you will open the homepage of the website, one message you will get that this website will install cookies on your browser. You accept it. If you don't accept, they will not allow you to log into the website. So what happens? As soon as you accept, the, you know, the website will install some cookies on your browser, and that the cookies can do this kind of an unethical thing as well. Okay. Now, what should be done if recommended computer security safeguards make life more difficult for customer and employees? This is another issue. Now, this what safeguard is recommended by the organization, it can sometimes make people's life difficult, okay, resulting in lost sales and increasing cost, right? So it may also happen. Like, you know, say there is certainly some mobile phone comes, which every time you want to call somebody, you have to enter. There is no other option. You have to enter PIN code, passcode, and all these things, and some password. Okay, then you will not like to use that mobile. Even that mobile is more secure. Then to deal with the incident, the Computer Emergency Response Team Coordination Center, the CERT, was established in 1988 at Software Engineering Institute, federally funded research and development center at Carnegie Mellon. So this CERT is nowadays, most of the countries are having their CERT. India is also having CERT. We call it CERT. CERTIN. This IN here, IN is for India. So CERT India we have. Okay. Then what are the basic activity they does? Study the internet security vulnerabilities. Then handle computer security incidents. Publish security alerts. Research long-term changes in the network system. Develop information and training, and conduct ongoing public awareness campaign. Every cyber program, then internet crime complaint centers or other organizations which are related to this. Then some statistics. These are even the old statistics, but important. The number of security problem response reported to CERT grew, 1997 and 2003 from 2,134 to, you can see, 137,529. So from 2004, the CERT RCC no longer publishing the number of incident reported. But I think in India, the CERT also disclosed this data. Okay. So advantages of ethical hacking, advantage of ethical codes. So what are the advantages of having some ethical codes? It adds clarity to the understanding of acceptable standard of behavior, then communicates common guidelines for everyone to follow, What happened if you don't follow the organization's ethical code? That also going to be, you know, defined there itself. Then, you know, if you see in SCM gives voluntary, then State Bar Association revoke the license. Say somebody is a member of State Bar Association and does not follow the ethical codes of State Bar Council, they can revoke the license. Okay. Then what are the disadvantages of having some ethical code? So may not reflect the ethical of every member of the group, because you know there will be some member in the group who will believe in something, you know, something else, or they don't think the most of the people, the majority of people feels correct or ethical. Some people may not feel that they are ethical, you understand this is a big debate in India. So in India, you know, we will see that many people give this argument that majority's opinion does not mean it is the correct opinion, but the world runs on the majority's opinion, right? Then many times it doesn't enforce its code of conduct, not a legal document. Okay, so most of the time it is not enforceable, because it's a code of conduct, right? It just gives recommendation. You should do like this, do like that, but it is not a legal document. It never speaks about if you don't do this, what punishment will be given to you, or whatever, what punishment will be awarded to you. That is not going to be written into it, okay? Because there is reason actually, because that part again, if somebody is going to do something unethical and it is going to be at some level of offense, like crime, then it is going to be handed over to the law. Now, challenges: increasing complexity of and increasing vulnerabilities. So the computing environment has become very complex nowadays. So this is a big challenge to understand, you know, who is doing what in the network, in the office. Tracking the people is very hard nowadays. Now, network, computer, operating system, application, website, switches, routers, and gateways are interconnected and driven by hundreds of millions of lines of code. So if there is somewhere some mistake, some security backdoor, it is quite hard to find out all the time. Okay, then the number of possible entry points to a network expands continually as more devices are added, now increasing the possibilities of security breaches. Okay, so that the first class also I was telling you that there is numerous entry point. You can't say this is the only entry point to the internet. Anybody is going to getting connected to the internet with a new device, he is an entry point, right? So he can generate data, he can post anything, he can do anything. Right. So it is these entry points are increasing continuously. This also increasing the possibilities of security breaches. Right. Then other challenges like higher computer user exceptions, right? Expectations like time means money, health breaks are under instance pressure to provide fast response to users' question. But most of the time, companies are not investing much of the money behind the health breaks or technical supports for security. Okay, then sometimes forgets to verify users' identity or to check authorization to perform the requested action. Okay, so this is another error happened that some user can if you think about a company with 1,000 or like that number of employees, then some person can get a fake identity and credential and can log in into the company and do something unlawful, right? So it depends that how that user's identity is going to be checked, and to check the authentication too far from the request actions. If somebody is requesting to some action, then that person need to be authenticated properly. Then expanding and changing system introduce new risks, like business had moved from the era of standalone computers to a network era, and personal computers connect to the internet with millions of other computers, all capable of sharing information, right? And then e-commerce, mobile computing, collaborative work group, global businesses are widely using this internet, and they are communicating their confidential data, and they're sharing the data online. So it increases the risk. Then it is increasingly difficult to keep up with the pace of technological change, successfully perform and ongoing assessment of new security risks, and implement appropriate implement approaches for dealing with them. Okay. Then another is increases reliance on commercial software, on reliance on commercial software with known vulnerability. So many people still using commercial softwares which are having some known vulnerabilities. Okay, but most of the people does not consider them actually. So then, like exploit is an attack on an information system that take advantage of a particular system vulnerability. So what is the attack? Attack is nothing but some system is having some vulnerabilities. Okay, some vulnerability. Now, if somebody is able to exploit this vulnerability, then it is going to be called as an attack. Okay, often this attack is due to poor system design or implementation. Okay, so system design and implementation is the network architecture, then how these firewalls are placed in, and they are properly configured or not, all these things matters. Okay, once vulnerability is disclosed, the software developer creates and issues a fix or patch to eliminate the problem. Now, users are responsible for obtaining and installing the patch. Now, most of the times it happens that the software developers have developed the patch and they have make it public, but the users are careless, they are not installing the patch on time, so there remains vulnerable to the attackers. Okay, any delay in installing a patch exposes the user to a security breach. Right, that means that is what I was telling you, that if the users are reluctant, they are careless of installing the patch on time, this giving this time, delaying the thing, that this delay may lead the organization or the computer systems to some new security breach. Right, now a rate of discovering software vulnerabilities exceed 10 per day, creating a serious work overload for the developers who are responsible for the security fixes. So so to at least 10 vulnerabilities are going to be reported every day, and that is a huge workload for the people who are doing the developer, the software developers who are developing these security fixes. Okay, then challenges increasing the reliance on commercial software with known vulnerabilities. Again, if we see the zero-day attack takes place before the security community or a software developer knows about the vulnerability or has been able to repair it. So what happens in zero-day attacks? Say it was happened, I think, with Windows 7 or Vista, I think. Had zero day attack. So some software is released, okay, and all over the world many people have installed those software on their systems, okay, and everybody whatever company have developed the software and whoever installed the software, everybody are unaware that there is some vulnerability in the software, but attackers are very smart. You know, as soon as it is going to be, you know, released, the attacker will start searching for vulnerabilities. So as soon as they get some vulnerability, they exploit it, and they get chance. They get chance to make make attack to huge number of computers, because this is a new vulnerability they have found out in the new software, and the developer of the software and whoever installed it, nobody is aware about it. Okay? So, like coronavirus came at the beginning. So everybody was unaware, even the doctors, research scientists, government, nobody knows what to do. So better to do, what is best to do is lockdown. So that is what happened. That is called what? A zero-day attack. But slowly, vaccinations came, some method of treatment came, right? So the same way. Then once the zero-day attack going to be public, after that, definitely the software developers or whoever is selling the software, they will develop patch. Okay, immediately this patch is going to be public, and all the customer need to be installed those patches immediately. Okay, now malicious hackers are getting better and faster in exploiting flaws. So these hackers are getting better because they are getting better systems to do research, better tools they are developing. Okay, they are getting a good internet connection and everything, right? So they are becoming faster and better. Okay, the SQL slammer worm, so this is a worm, appeared in January 2004, 8 months after the vulnerability it targeted was disclosed. So can you imagine, for 8 months this worm was active over the internet, and after that this targeted was disclosed, that people came to know that there is some worm going, is active on the internet. In August 2005, the JetOV computer worm, this is another worm, began targeting corporate network that run Windows 2000 less than a week after Microsoft released a critical patch addressing the vulnerability. So in this case, you can see within 1 week, Microsoft was able to release the patch against this virus, or to stop this virus to infect Microsoft machines. Okay. So in an attempt to avoid further attacks and ultimate zero-day attack, computer security firms and software maintenance manufacturers are paying hackers to identify vulnerabilities before they can be exploited. So what strategy these companies are taking right now, before releasing a software for sale, they are hiring the attackers or hackers. Okay, this is software we have developed. If you can find any of the flaws, or if you can make any attack successfully, you will get rewarded by this much amount of money. Okay, so they give a good lump sum money. So before release, they try to detect or find out the zero day attack vulnerabilities. Okay, so this is very important, and this is a quite standard practice nowadays. Okay. Okay, so